In this final video for our series, we're going to set our game up to use touchscreen controls. To do this, we're going to switch our build target from the default standalone build target to iOS, and we're going to add some code to our player script to handle touchscreen input. Let's go to File, Build Settings. Make sure that your main scene is added to the scenes in the build, and then we're going to click iOS and choose Switch Platform. With that done, we can close our build settings, and we're going to open our player script in MonoDevelop. In the player script, the first thing that we're going to add is a private vector2 called TouchOrigin. We're going to use TouchOrigin to record the place where the player's finger started touching our touchscreen. We're going to initialize it to negative vector2.1, which is going to be a position off the screen. This means that our conditional that we're going to use to check and see if there has been any touch input will initially evaluate to false until there actually is a touch, which changes TouchOrigin. In our update function, we're going to add the mobile input code. Now, we're actually going to add some platform-specific code in here, which is going to check what platform the game is running on and use appropriate input controls. So we're initially going to check if we're running in a standalone build of our application or we're running in a web player, in which case we're going to want to continue to use the keyboard controls that we've been using thus far. If we're not running in a standalone build or a web player, we're going to use else to encompass all other build targets, including iOS, Android, Windows Phone 8, etc. Next, we're going to check if input.touchCount is greater than 0, meaning the input system has registered one or more touches. If that's true, we're going to store the first touch detected in a variable of the type touch called myTouch. In this case, we're just going to grab the first touch and ignore all other touches because the game is only going to support a single finger swiping in the cardinal directions. Next, we're going to check the phase of that touch and make sure that it's equal to began by checking its touch phase so that we can determine that this is the beginning of a touch on the screen. If that's true, we're going to set our variable touch origin to equal the position of myTouch. If the touch phase is not began, we're going to check if the touch phase is equal to ended, and if the touch origin is greater than or equal to 0. Since we initialized touch origin to -1, we can now check if we had a touch that ended, meaning the finger lifted off the screen, and if the touch origin dot x is greater than or equal to 0, meaning the touch is inside the bounds of the screen and has changed from the value that we initialized it to when we declared it and that it has ended. If that is the case, we're going to declare a vector2 called touchEnd and set it to equal myTouch.position. Next, we're going to calculate the difference between the beginning and end of the touch on the x-axis. We're going to declare a float called x and set it to equal touchEnd.x minus touchOrigin.x. By doing this, we get the difference between the two touches on the x-axis, and therefore we can get a direction to move in. We're going to do the same on the y, and then we're going to set touchOrigin.x to -1 so that our conditional doesn't repeatedly evaluate to true. Because touch controls are not always in a perfectly straight line, we're going to have to take a guess at the user's intent with their touch. And so what we're going to do is we're going to figure out if the touch was generally more horizontal or generally more vertical in a given direction. We're going to do this using mathf.absolute and checking if x was greater than y. If x is greater than y, we're then going to check if x is greater than 0 to determine whether it's a positive or negative number, and thereby what direction the user is trying to swipe in. We are then going to set horizontal to 1 or -1 accordingly. If the difference is not greater along the x-axis, then what we're going to do is we're going to set vertical to equal 1 or -1. We're going to add an endif statement at the end of our mobile code. Now, to tie this back into the code that we wrote earlier when we wrote the original player movement code, the values that we were previously getting using input.getAccessRaw from the input manager from the keyboard, which we stored into horizontal and vertical respectively, are instead being set in our touchscreen code using swipes. If we've determined that they've changed in this frame, meaning they're no longer equal to zero, the values they were initialized with, we're going to call attempt move and pass in horizontal and vertical. Now that our touch code is completed, you'll be able to test the game using Unity Remote or build to your touch device of choice. It's worth noting that if you want to continue testing with the keyboard in the editor, you'll need to either change the build target back to standalone, or you can add an additional condition to our first if statement, if Unity Editor. And there we have it. If you want to give this a test, you can download the Unity Remote app for your mobile or tablet device and hook your device up to the computer you're running Unity on with a USB cable, and you should be able to test your game in the editor. Thanks so much for watching, and I hope this was helpful for you.